everybody. My name is Chanvi and I'm from Collegedunia. Collegedunia.com is India's leading college search portal, helping students find the right college and giving them apt information when it comes to colleges, courses, and exams. We are a trustworthy site when it comes to information on higher education, and our team works day and night so that the students have access to pertinent and latest education information at all times. Today, we are here at the lovely capital city of Tamil Nadu, Chennai, and we are here at SRM Institute of Science and Technology. Formerly known as SRM University, this institute is one of the top-ranked institutions in the country and offers a plethora of undergraduate, postgraduate, and doctoral programs to over 38,000 of its students. Today, we will be meeting Professor Sandeep Sancheti, the Vice Chancellor of this fine university itself. Let's see what the university has in store for its aspiring students. Hello, sir. Thank you so much for having us here on behalf of Collegedunia.
Welcome, Janvi.
Firstly, I would like to congratulate you on becoming the President of Association of Indian Universities, sir.
Thank you so much. It's a position of eminence which allows me to do many, many good things in the academic world.
So firstly, talking about you, you have been in the education sector for over 35 years now. And you have seen it go through the ups and downs. Now, so what are some of the key changes that you have observed over these years?
I think the education today is becoming student-centric, is what I would say. We are becoming learner-centric. We want to make them lifelong learners. We want to deliver them the ability of learning what they want to learn. And we also are allowing them the diversity of what they want to learn.
So the spontaneity is there and the education sector is, you know, moving forward along with the students.
Yes, very much. Because without that, it would lose the relevance, lose the purpose. Right. And of course, today, the education has become omnipresent. The education is required to be anywhere, anytime, any mode, any language, any form, any combination. And with that focus, you can say that there can be various degrees, diplomas, certificates, and so on and so forth. So education, I would say, has opened up in a big way today to suit the needs of the society.
So in an interview, you mentioned that Indian universities, instead of blindly following what foreign universities are doing, they should come up with their own education system.
Correct.
Which is student-centric and believing in branchless engineering. What is SRM doing in that direction?
I find that when the admissions happen in engineering streams, most of the people are confused. Most of the students are confused about what branch of engineering should they take. We practically very well know that if you are not in top 200, 500 ranks of IIT, JEE, either you don't get the institution of your choice called IIT or you don't get the branch of your choice. So right from 500th rank onwards, if you are making a compromise, then one should know which compromise to be made in terms of taking an institution and a branch. So if we remove one of the element of a gray area called branch, I think we'll facilitate them to go to better institutions automatically, irrespective of the branch. We don't want to teach them what we want to teach. We want them to learn what they want to learn.
Right, and in that case, they would be making a more informed decision because they've already studied in the first year. Now they've already decided what they want to become in their life.
Obviously, there are lots of beauties if one has to do what we call branchless engineering.
Right, so the idea basically comes from the root that while they're actually starting from the probably after 1 year they want to go for another stream and then, you know, leave the one that they were doing. Is that very common that you observe?
No, it's not common. That is what I want them to do. Okay. It's not common currently because seats are fixed, numbers are frozen. Right. And for everything there is a quota given by the approving agencies like AICT. And because of that, if it's 60, it has to be 60. If another student with the same quality and zeal want to do it, we cannot allow them. So that's a foundation. We don't want that. And this branchless engineering concept possibly will overcome such shortcomings.
So can we say that SRM is one of the very first institutes to take up with branchless engineering and there are many more to come, you know, following the same path?
Yes. And in a limited way, I can say that we have started exploring that. And we are going to be a front runner. But to make it fully operational and to call it as a fully operational thing would take some more time now.
So apart from being the Vice Chancellor of this fine institute, you're also the President of Association of Indian Universities. So how exactly do you foster inter-university coordination and what exactly are you doing to better the education system in India?
AIU is a very, very pious, well-known, well-established body, established in 1925. Fortunately, it's an institution or organization which has been led by the former presidents of India like Dr. Jakir Hussain, Dr. Radhakrishnan also, and also Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, who was an eminent politician and leader who founded Jansang. It has main four activities right now, I would say. So we facilitate, number one, internationalization, which is now the order of the day, which will bring us in the top 200 or top 100, all these, because we need a lot of international faculty, international students. So AIU facilitates internationalization. AIU also facilitates what we call the equivalences of degrees between various boards, universities, international. It facilitates all the sports domain activities in the country, in the higher education, because there is no body which does that. So we run around 125 sports in the country at inter-university level, zonal level, national level, and there is a very famous Maka Trophy which we run. The fourth one happens to be the one on the cultural side. Same is the point like the sports. The cultural side is also unattended or not being looked after by any central agency. So we do that. But on top of that, on all four of them is the policy, planning and kind of a dissemination of information and various things.
So as we all know, SRM is a brand name in itself and it has maintained this since the time it was established. Now you being newly appointed Vice Chancellor of this institute, how do you plan to further enhance it or strengthen this brand name?
The brand name is established, but to continue the branding, one has to keep performing well. So number one, whatever we have done successfully till now or we have been doing has to be strengthened further, continued with a little bit more improvement or innovation or whatever you can say, finesse. That is one thing. And in recent times alone, we have done a lot of changes in the academic world. We have to promote self-learning. So we have found new mechanisms of self-learning. We have to promote industrialization. We have started sending faculty from our side to go for that industry, spend time with them for up to 15 days, learn from them what are their tools, tackles, practices, problems, and bring them into teaching learning. Similarly, we send our brighter students around, you can say 10% of our students go abroad, and those people get exposed to internationalization, various different experiences, whether it is entrepreneurship or research or doing something with the industry. One of the core factors today for the branding happens to be research. And within research, a high-end activity is the patenting. You'll be very happy to know that SRM has done exceedingly well in 2018, where it got Government of India's Patent and Commercialization Award.
SRM has bagged so many awards over these years. So what are some of the key achievements that you would like to share with us?
The measurable achievements obviously happens to be in the domain of what we call research. In last 6 months alone, we have filed more than 50 patents. Thank you so much. And we invest a lot of money in research. Something like 6 to 7% of our budget, annual budget, goes towards research. And whereas the general norm is less than 3 or 3%, you'll be very happy to know that in 2011-12, SRM launched an SRM satellite, which was meant for functioning for 3 years. But even today, more than double its life, it is functioning and it's doing its job. Similar set of awards have come to us in the teaching domain. As I told you that the NPTEL award has come. Amongst the award, the biggest award for anyone would be the ranking and the rating. We have been very high in the NIRF ranking. Similarly, we have the accreditation, which is very, very high. Till last 6 years, we had a 3.50 score from the NAC. And in the recent times, we have received 3.55, which brings us to the category one institution. We also have a good ranking from, in certain programs, not all the programs, from the foreign agencies, which are what we call as the ABET, the US agency, which has accredited our engineering programs. the Institution of Electrical Engineers, IET, from the UK has accredited some of our programs. And similarly, the QS has given us 4 stars ranking for an overall performance and 5 stars, the highest stars, in various categories of our functioning.
So again, talking about research, so also on the website I was looking, and you know, I found that a lot of importance has been given to research in this particular institute. So how exactly do you, you know, encourage the students to take up research apart from the regular curriculum?
I might have touched base with some of the points in the students' domain. One is that allowing them to take the research track somewhere in between is what we are opening up to. Another one is the Students Abroad Program, SAP, which is our USP, and large number of them go there. And we have also the students from 62 countries of the world already studying with us. We have a very structured, well-structured fab lab, which is 24/7. You can say it's a tinkering lab in a way, where anyone can experiment and give shape to their designs with beautiful facilities and open working spaces. And then, of course, we have the Entrepreneurship Promotion Center, which will incubate those companies, give them the spaces and all the support. As a result of all this desire, good work or good performance, Government of India under IEDC, that Entrepreneurship Development Cell, has given us something like 3 crores of funding in recent times. So there are many avenues by which we promote our students in research, innovation and technology development. For our faculty, we also provide lots of support in terms of seed grants, which will allow them to start research, and that amount goes up to rupees 50 lakhs, which is pretty high by any imagination or standard. Within the SRM setup, we have a research institution. In that research institution, around 150 faculty members are there. Those faculty members are primarily driving our research. They do less teaching and more research. One of the things which will be very unique to SRM is a high performance computing. In simple terms, you can call it supercomputer. And this supercomputer is very powerful, very strong, and this is where we have spent something like 6 crores of rupees in recent times.
So earlier in the interview, you mentioned that a lot of courses are offered to the students from this particular institute. So similarly, SRM's branch in Kattakuluthur has recently come up with Faculty of Agriculture Sciences.
Yeah.
Now, as you all know, Agriculture Sciences is not really the topmost choice among students currently. So what exactly is the institute going to do to popularize this particular course among the students?
Yes, agriculture is not necessarily the flavor of, you can say, top-notch students, but then it is a flavor of the country that they need it most. We have 180 acres of land in the neighborhood where we'll support the entire agriculture space. We have started with a specialization of horticulture, but today's agriculture needs a lot of digital things in terms of sensing. It needs a lot of mechanization in terms of mechanical tools and tackles. It needs a lot of chemical things and biomedical things in terms of controlling diseases or maybe supporting growth and all that. All those specializations are available in SRM today. Whereas in a standalone agriculture university or a college, these things would not be there. So in a longer run, we will have a great deal of advantage in supporting agriculture-like programs.
So as we were talking about SAP and student exchange programs, I feel that this particular institute really embraces its tie-ups with other universities, whether it's foreign universities like the Flinders University in Australia. So what other tie-ups does SRM have from other universities? Also, how exactly are they helping the students which are currently studying in SRM?
Our students go to all the top-notch universities of the world. I think if I count top 15 in the world, at least 5 to 6 are the ones where our students are going regularly. For that matter, Harvard, Stanford, MIT, University of California, Berkeley, NTU, NUS, which are ranked 10th and 11th in the world. And likewise, the list is pretty long. We have more than 150 MOUs. As I said, large number of countries are represented in our portfolio or interest. And we have had recently, just a few days back, a delegation from Indonesia for doing a lot of activities and partnerships. And tomorrow we'll have a delegation from Ghana coming here So we are also helping the other institutions who may take advantage of us, and we are also gaining from the others who can give us the advantage. To promote internationalization, one need to do lots of good activities. Number one, accept the international standards, accept the international benchmarks. For the first time in the history of the College Board, which is based in US, it has moved out and moved out to India. And SRM is one of its core partners in promoting them in India. Popular exam they conduct is SAT, SAT 1, SAT 2, SAT Advanced, which is a benchmark accepted world over for international admissions.
So can you please elaborate more on the placement cell and the placement drive that is there at SRM? How does the placement cell really ensure that there is smooth working of the placement drives?
Placement is generally not called as placement alone. In most cases, the name is training and placement, or PTP, Professor of Training and Placement. But in most cases, this training component is missing, only placement happens. We do the training also, and we have a setup called CDC, Career Development Center. Right from first year onwards, every semester CDC will deliver one course to them, which is an official course for which they have to enroll, and they learn anything they want to learn, whether they want to enhance analytical ability, communication ability, they want to learn more about coding, they want to learn more about something else which is there. Talking about placements, SRM is doing extremely well in spite of having large number of students to be placed. Last year alone, we had 532 companies who visited us for placements, out of which around 300 plus were for IT and 200 plus were for the core kind of placements. We have been able to maintain the placement records somewhere between 60 to 70%, which I consider to be very high and very good. One of the good example of placement has come to us only yesterday evening, when one of our girl got placed in Microsoft with a package of 38.5 lakhs. Yeah. So such successes are coming to us regularly. Large placements are happening. The overall package of placement is going up, and the placement performance is also going up.
So more and more students are inclined towards opening their own businesses, and you know, there's like a startup culture that is now going on. So what exactly is SRM doing to promote this, or you know, to help the student really come up with the ideas and innovate?
Focused efforts of the startup are in form of IEDC, where we are investing overall around 5 crores, 3 crores by the government and 2 crores by us. So that's a huge setup. We have tinkering labs, we have the fab labs which are there. Those are available 24/7. We have found a model here that in the last 6 months of their study here, when they do a final year project, we have allowed them that the 6 months can be purely focused on entrepreneurship, and their entrepreneurship would be counted as a final year project. That will be assessed for award of the degrees. Whether they are good in entrepreneurship effort or bad is not the question. Whether they attempted entrepreneurship seriously is what will bring them the points for that particular project, and they will get the degree. I am very, very happy to tell you that 15 of my students were spending one full semester, 6 months, in UC Berkeley this year in 2018 alone, purely with a focus on entrepreneurship.
So despite of the intelligent innovations that a student might have in his mind, I think funding is a problem that a young student can face. So sir, do they get an opportunity to pitch their ideas to the institute as well? Does the institute help them in that manner as well?
My belief is there is no dearth of money for ideas today, and there are many venture capitalists who are eyeing the good ideas and good functionalities and good products world over, and hackathons are actually meant for that, where these people very closely watch what is there and then they work with them. For an institution to work with an old student for a long time would be difficult, so we nurture them for a year or two, and then we'll have to shake hand and say thank you and let the next generation of students get nurtured by us. Whereas the venture capitalist and the external support system for new enterprises will take care of them later. So we do these transitions very effectively, and obviously we not only give them money, we give them our might, we give them our money, we give them our places also, and every support which is needed by them is given, including the guidance and the technology support.
So a hackathon is something from the digital age, and education sector itself is gradually moving towards the digital age. What is SRM doing to prepare the students for the same?
We are using an integrated ERP since 2005, That means from admission to degree or graduation or placement is what we take them through the electronic mediums or digital mediums, as you will say. And now we are raring to go for a new generation system. All payments, all processes, all registrations, all examinations are being taken care through the things which are electronic methods. And that is the reason why we declare all our results in 11 days, simply 11 days, though we have a population of around 50,000 students or more.
So tell us more about SRM's campus and infrastructure facilities.
SRM has campuses throughout the country, but the one I'm going to talk to you about is the one in Kanchipuram, Chennai. And this campus is around 170 acres, surrounded on three sides by the lakes and the natural water which is there. Very green, very clean, and as a result, it was in top 50 of the Swachhta ranking of the MHRD last year. It has a built-up area of around 1 crore square feet, kind of a built-up area is already there in the entire campus. Around 15,000-16,000 students can live in the beautifully done hostels. There are around 24 messes in which they can eat the food of variety they want. North Indian, South Indian, others, veg, non-veg, which is there. Recently, we procured one HR10, the high resolution transmission electron microscope, which is costing us 5.6 crores. SRM is one of the best in the southern India in terms of the sporting performance. We have three indoor stadiums, and then we have all dedicated facilities for everything which you'll require in sporting. We have a budget for sports support alone for the student support, which we need to give, is more than 10 crores.
So what are some of the future goals that you have in mind for SRM Institute?
Our immediate task in next 15 years is that we become, or we come in the ratings which are top 200 in the world, and possibly one of the best in India. This is one ambition. Another ambition is Government of India has started giving you more liberty through categorization. We have attained the highest categorization. We have attained the highest NAC accreditation. We will seek similar features from large number of, you can say, international organizations to give us the highest ratings which are there. And finally, we also would like to become IOE, Institution of Eminence, which will give us more liberty to experiment with research and academics which are there.
So any message that you would like to share with the coming youth and aspiring students?
Students are going to be the real estate of the future of any country. Students are going to be the one which will define whether it's an advanced or a non-advanced country. Students are the one who will make it big or small. They'll have to dream differently, think differently, do differently. And therefore, they'll have to take the risk, face the challenges, and be more serious about what they are attempting. Somehow, sometimes we feel that that focus is lacking in Indian students for certain reasons. But we have the highest potential in terms of intellect. We are the most laborious set. We have seen most toughest conditions to live and to work. We have all the building blocks of the good person, competent professional to be there. Only thing, we have to put that jigsaw together, work towards our ambition, work towards our goal, be focused, be ready to change, and enjoy it also. That's the most important.
Thank you so much for your time, sir. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
Thank you.